This week is the week of Valentine's, right?
Yeah.
So those who are single are probably a little bit nervous. Kind of looking around, this is not a good time for me, you know. But and those who are in a relationship also very nervous. Look, now I'm buying flowers and chocolates and all of those kind of things. But I just wanna tell you about a love story that we find in the Bible. It's actually a very tragic love story. Kind of the original love story. This is a story between Adam and Eve, right? Maybe if you can just put it up for me. I'm gonna go through the whole of chapter 3. So I need you just to follow with me. Are the kids joining us? Okay. Alright. So it says, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in the garden? You see that the serpent is actually repeating now, or quoting what the Lord had said. Even though the Lord had said these words to the man and to the woman, right? There's no record of the serpent being present at the time when the Lord was commanding the man and the woman. But the serpent is, because it's crafty, it's quoting what the Lord had said, but kind of putting doubt in the woman's mind. Did God really say, you must not eat of any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the tree in the garden. But God did say, you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman. God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. And now before we go to the next verse, you can just go through it, but we'll talk about it now. Here's the scenario, think about it. The serpent offers the woman this fruit, right? The woman looks at it, it's good to eat, and she eats it. But the husband is standing right there with her. And now the husband, meaning Adam, let's say the man, Adam says nothing to stop this transaction that is taking place. And now here's where the tragedy actually comes in, is Adam, before even Eve came, Adam, remember, was in constant communion with the Lord. The Lord had given Adam a job to name the animals and to look after the garden, to keep the garden. We talked about this, I think, on Sunday afternoon when we were doing the garden with the apostle. So the man knows what the Lord had said. The man has a relationship, communion with the Lord on a daily basis. And now he's in this moment where the woman is offering him the fruit that is now from the serpent. And now you can imagine what's going on in his mind. If we can really slow things down for him, if we take things at a really, like a very slow motion, at a very slow pace, that the Lord has given me this woman, right? And remember, if you look at chapter 2, Adam did not ask for a partner. The Lord saw that it was good for Adam to have a partner because Adam needed someone to help him, right? And then isn't it like that in our lives as well? That every time when you're looking for someone, like, oh, I need a person, I'm lonely, this, you end up getting into all sorts of trouble. You end up meeting all kinds of wrong men or people, of the wrong people, or you are the wrong person for those people and you miss out their lives. And the moment you just sit down and you say, I'm just concentrating on my relationship with the Lord, then the Lord brings somebody to you. Amen. All right. But now here's the thing. come to this point where there's this moment, like even we've paused there where Adam is, where Eve is like this and Adam is like, you know, thinking, okay, must I reach my hand out to eat this thing, or, you know, that's where we are now. There was nothing wrong with Eve, because the Lord created Eve to help Adam, you know. So we cannot be lambasting Eve and say, oh, Eve is bad, Eve is this. No, the original intent for Eve was to help Adam. Because Adam had a kingdom mandate. The Lord had given Adam a godly job, you know, which is to keep the garden and to work the garden and to name the animals. And Eve was there to assist and to help him in this job, right? So that was the original intent of Adam. And it, the introduction of Eve into Adam's life, remember, if you read chapter 2 of Genesis, the Lord brought different types of animals to Adam and introduced them, like, okay, this, but there was none that was found, that Adam was like, okay, now this is the one. You know, all of them, Adam was like, oh, okay, no, that's a giraffe, no, no, that's a donkey, that's a mosquito, no, I can't be, you know, there's a mosquito. Adam knew, he had a vision for, you know, who he was and what he wanted. Even though certain animals or whatever came into his life, he knew that, you know, this is not the right one. And he didn't compromise. There is not a time where he compromises and he's like, okay, maybe I'll take a chicken because I'm so lonely. You know, I'll just go and maybe take a lion. That thing would have eaten him up in the next morning. Can't go to bed with a lion and go miss you. You know. So, but when the Lord brought Eve, immediately, instantly he recognized, now this is born of my womb. This is the one for me. You know. So he was patient in his waiting for the Lord to bring the right person to him. Okay? So now here's where the tragedy happened. In that moment where Adam actually chose Eve instead of choosing the Lord. Where Eve presented this fruit to him. And I want to believe that in that moment he saw, because now Eve had already eaten, remember. Eve took a bite, but the Bible says, or the Bible does not record what happened to Eve. Eve's eyes were not open at that moment. Okay, you can open it, just open the verse again, so that we can have a look at it very carefully. Verse 6. Yeah. So when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. See, at this point, nothing is happening. Her eyes are not opened, right? She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. And then verse 7. So now only then, when both of them had eaten, were their eyes opened. Only then. So now Adam is looking, okay, she ate of the fruit. The Lord has commanded us not to eat. But now he realizes, okay, now my wife has sinned, has stepped into sin. And now what did Adam do? He had a choice to make in that moment. Obey the Lord or step into death with my wife or my husband. And what did he do? He decided to take a step into death where Eve was. And this is now where the tragedy began, which is now we are, what we're still paying for even to this day. Yeah. And that very often, sometimes you are the Adam in a relationship, or you are even the Eve in a relationship, where your partner offers you something that you know is against God. What am I talking about? I mean, the Lord will tell you that He will give you a job. Maybe you don't have a job at the time. Or the Lord will promise you that I'm going to give you a child. Or I'm going to give you this, you know. But we all know that the Lord wants the Lord's time. But then your partner, not even just your partner, but probably even your mother, or maybe you are the mother, and you say to your child, but did the Lord really say this? You know, and at that moment, what fruit are we giving? We're giving the fruit of doubt to that person, to the person that you're in a relationship with. You know, did the Lord really say that we're going to move, or we're going to get a better, or we're bigger pits. Did the Lord really say, or put these in your mind, or did the Lord really, you know, that fruit that we planted and we offered to our partner in that moment, and at that time we are becoming, or we're taking on the role of Eve as the enemy intended, not as the Lord intended. The Lord intends that in a relationship, when He gives you a partner, that you become the Eve that He intends for you to be. Help your partner, you know, whatever dreams, whatever job, whatever kingdom mandate that the Lord has given to your partner, your job is to help them. Your job is to protect that kingdom mandate. Sometimes even protect the kingdom mandate from them. And remind them every single morning, hey, get up, are you doing what the Lord has created you to do? Are you doing the Lord's assignment today? If they're not doing it, then you pray, and you push, you pray with them. You ask, oh, yeah, let's open the Bible together. Let's pray together. That is your job. That is the original intent of the Eve that God has created you to be. Right? And at the same time, when you take on Adam's persona, or when we're in Adam's shoes at the moment, how do you react when your partner or the person that you're in a relationship with, let's say even your mother, when they come to you and they give you or they plant their seeds of doubt? Do we step into them and say, hey, but maybe God didn't really say it, I don't really remember anymore. You know, because now that is us stepping into this tragedy that we see, that this love story between Adam and Eve, how it unfolded. You know, it's kind of like, what did they, Romeo and Juliet, I'm not really, yeah, but they died, yeah, something like that. It's kind of like that, really. It's actually quite sad, you know. But we do that to each other. We do that. I was telling, who was I telling? Oh, Zen, yeah, I was telling you that a revelation that the Lord gave me once when I went to a wedding. And you know these old cliches that the Lord created. Yeah? Oh, I know the Lord loves me because He created you for me. You know? And those are nice, because you know, you hear somebody say that, you start to cry. The Lord created them. Yeah, no, the Lord loves them. No, listen. The Lord did not create that person for you. The Lord created that person for Himself. You know, just like the Lord created me for Him, the Lord created Nomsa for Himself, not for me. I can't, you know, make such claims. No, I can't. You know, and the Lord didn't bring us together so that we can, you know, be all lovey-dovey. No, the Lord brought us together for Him, for His glory, because there's a kingdom mandate that needs to be done. And she needs help just as much as I need help. That's why He put us together, paired us together. For that kingdom movement. Amen. You know, not for us to now go walk in the sunset and eat grapes and strawberries and chocolate. Well, there's nothing wrong with grapes and strawberries, actually, like those. But that's not the intention of the Lord of putting or pairing people together. Because here's the thing, the Lord is your first true love. That is what you must always do. You must always be your first true love. And He is the one that you must always choose before anything else. Not your partner. Your partner, that's why we call them your number two. Your number one is the Lord.
Amen.
Even here's this woman. She married this guy, and now the guy is dead, and now another brother came, and you know, this brother married her. Now she has like multiple husbands. Now what happens in heaven? Then the Lord Jesus answered, there's none of that there. You know, but now we're calling boy in heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. How do we implement kind of a marriage type of thing on earth as it is in heaven? The Lord is your first love. That's all it is. You know, the Lord is your first love. The Lord comes first before anything else. Matthew 6:33 tells us that seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Righteousness means to be in right standing with God. So even in your relationship, use godly wisdom. Even in the way you love your partner and how you should love your partner. Exercise only wisdom. Ask the Lord, oh, okay, Lord, how must I love this person today? Let it be a daily question. Because in you asking that question, it means you're already praying for your spouse, for your partner. You know, you're already praying for them. And the Lord will give you wisdom. Okay, now buy the flowers today, or pick flowers, or give them kind words, or, you know, whatever. But the fear of the Lord is what must lead you in how you handle your relationship and how you treat your partner. For me, it's like, you know, what the parents of your spouse, how sometimes you the first day when you go and you meet them, how scared you even peeing in your pants. It's a terrifying thing. You know? Because you know, those people love this person and they will do anything for them. They will even kill you if you hurt their daughter or their son. You know. You know that. And you do it. You try and you present yourself well. Even though you're like, you put on a tie that day, you comb your hair, even though you haven't combed your hair like months or even washed your hair. But on that day, the word is like, if you borrow your friend's perfume, to borrow it, you know, to put, so you can smell nice and be presentable. Why? Because you want to show them that you're going to treat their child in the correct way. You know. Even though sometimes we don't do it, and we hurt our partners and our spouses, right? But it is that fear that I'm talking about. Now we're talking about the fear of the Lord. Remember that this is, your partner is the Lord's child. You know? So that's how you must look at it. To say, the Lord will come, and he will demand answers. Just like he did, just put up the verses there. When the Lord came back, you know, because the Bible says the Lord came in the cool of the day. Where is it? Verse 8. Huh? Yeah, verse 8. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden, in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, "Where are you?" And he answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, so I hid." You see, here's the thing. The Lord will come and ask for an account of the relationship. You know, he will ask for what has happened, where, in terms of where I have put you, where I have positioned you, and what I have given to you, where are you now? You know, how have you moved from what I have given you, from where I have put you? Where are we standing now? You know, and how have you been treating this child of mine that I have given to you, that I have given to you to help you, and for you to help them? The Lord will come and ask for an account. And we cannot now come and hide, because now you know that you've been beating them, that you've been hurting them, and you have not been treating them well. That day is coming when you will be asked such questions. Alright, he answered, "I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat?" Here's the thing, guys. Adam and Eve were naked all the time. You know, they didn't have clothes before. But after they'd eaten, and after their eyes were opened, then they knew that they were naked. So now how often do we, you know, you go along in life, there's so many things that you can say. Or people would say, would look at you and say, those things make you imperfect. In the Lord's eyes, you are perfect. But the world will look at you and say, oh, there's this thing wrong about you, oh, your height is weird, or you are too tall, or you are too big, or kind of thing. And we take on those things. And then, but that's not what the Lord said to you. You were short all along, and you were fine. There's nothing wrong with you. And when the Lord now asks you, "But where are you?" You say, I cannot do this job, Lord, because I don't have a qualification. Remember, the Lord put you in a position And you say, I cannot do it. I don't have the right mindset. I don't have the right intelligence to do this. And the Lord asks you, who told you that you are not intelligent enough? Who told you that you are not qualified? I put you there. I put you there. The man said, the woman you put here with me, see now what Adam is doing. He's blaming the serpent. He's blaming God. He's saying, God, you gave me this one. This one is the one, this is the problem here. It's you and this one, the problem here for me. The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. But where was, remember where was Adam? He was there all along. And he decided, he made the decision to step into death, to step into sin, following his way. He chose to go with him. But now he's, you know, they're tracking like God, but it's your fault, and if this woman's fault that you gave to me, they made you do this thing. Then the Lord said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. Again, the woman here, and she, no one is taking any type of responsibility here. She said, I'm sorry, I did this, but they just all like, it's this one's fault, it's that one's fault, you know. So the Lord said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. You can just stop with the messages. Because my message mainly is about that relationship. And the relationships that we have, that we need to do an introspection of how we are treating. How we are treating our partners. How we are treating the people that we are in a relationship with. Are we helping them to achieve their God-given mandate? You know, are we offering that help? Are we praying for our partners? Or are we praying for even our brothers or our siblings, for that matter, for our children? Because we are in a relationship with them. The Lord has partnered you with any person that you're in a relationship with. The Lord has partnered you with that person. How are you treating that relationship? Are we selfish to a point where we trample on their successes? We don't want them to succeed. That when we see them moving forward, you want your things to go before theirs. Are we really on that level, or are we asking the Lord for counsel? Are we asking the Lord to show us how to help them, to show us how to even love them, to show us how to comfort them, to show us how to celebrate with them when there's victory in their lives? Are we joining in that celebration? Not just in times of trouble, but in good times as well. How are we treating them? You know, whether you're single or whether you're in a relationship, it's all the same. It's all the same. Or are we even at a stage allowing ourselves to step into sin, to do the wrong things? Because now you're no longer choosing the Lord. Your focus is now no longer your number one. It's only your number two. Because now this one makes me feel good. You know, I want to just go with them wherever they go. Because maybe I'm afraid that I'm going to be lonely. If I don't do this wrong thing with this person, they're going to leave me and I will be single again. I don't want that. But you know what the Lord has told you. The Lord has told you that I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you. But now this person comes with this fruit and says, did the Lord really say he has plans for you? Did he really, really? Are you sure? And then once you start doubting, it means you have eaten. The fruit is already in your mouth. You may not have swallowed, but it's in your mouth. You know, and we need to spit it out. So the Lord must always be your number one in everything that you do. Because once the Lord is your number one, then number two is automatic, everything is fine. Everything will work out. Even if you have issues, even if there's problems, that you go to the Lord for any type of counsel. For you know, even just simple things. You pray for your partner, you pray for yourself, and you pray for your relationship. Apostle Deborah sent through some messages through the Nexus groups, through Pastor Lisa, about how the enemy is attacking relationships. So I said, yeah, because all the enemies, at this time, attacking relationships. But we so very often allow that to happen. It's so easy for the enemy to attack our relationships because you get into a relationship with the sole intention of how it's going to make you feel, or how your needs are going to be met, or how this person must meet all of your needs, or all your loneliness, or whatever it is that you're feeling. I want this person to fulfill all of those things, which is the opposite of how the Lord wants it. Remember, the Lord brought all these animals, and the Lord even brought Eve to Adam. Adam didn't go looking. The Lord brought them to him. And Adam said, accepted and made a choice. So, okay, yeah, no, I receive Eve, you know. So, we make it very easy for the enemy to attack us in our relationships because we don't put God first. We put our own selfish needs first, and we expect the person to meet all of those things, which is very unfair, because that's not their job. Their job is there to help you complete and to do and to run the race that the Lord has given you, has put before you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I want us, if you can just maybe play a song very silently in the background, just speak to Holy Spirit. Ask Holy Spirit to reveal to you the times when either you've been an Eve as the enemy intended, where you offered fruit of doubt or bad fruit or evil fruit to your partner or to the person that you're in a relationship with, or whether you've been in a position where Adam was and you chose to step into sin because of the person next to you that offered you the fruit. Just ask Holy Spirit to reveal that to you, and we're going to hand that over to the Lord right now. We're going to ask for forgiveness, and we're going to ask for the Lord to cleanse us and to start over, to show us how to move forward and how to treat each other in a godly manner going forward. Okay, just play it very silently and ask the Lord to heal you. And if you want, I'm not going to lay hands. And if you want some ministry, I'll stand up here in front with Pastor Jay. If you want to just have some time to talk, we'll just be up here. We'll offer you support. Okay. Pastor Jay, you can just...